Everyone, this is Hank Weaver. For the past year, this signature has announced the opening of Disneyland the show. Now it announces the opening of Disneyland the place. The people and eyes around the world are focused on these 160 acres here in Anaheim, California. This afternoon, Disneyland, the world's most fabulous kingdom, will be unveiled before an invitational world premiere, and you are guests. Art Linkletter will be your host, and with ABC crews and cameras on the spot, will guide you through this truly magic land. You are now in the press room of Disneyland, which is equipped to service over 1,000 members of the worldwide press here to cover this truly great event. And to start the proceedings, we take you to the entrance of Disneyland and your host, Art Linkletter.
That's not Art Linkletter. That's Mickey Mouse, the inimitable little character that started this whole story with Walt Disney 25 years ago, perhaps the most popular motion picture star in Hollywood. I'm standing here on the railroad tracks with helicopters roaring overhead and cars parking by the thousands, and I'm in front of the big Disneyland and Santa Fe Railroad Station. And down these tracks, in just a couple of seconds, will come Walt Disney himself barreling in a railroad train built to 5/8 miniature size. Well, this job in the next hour and a half is going to be a delight. I feel like Santa Claus with a $17 million bundle of gift packages all wrapped in whimsy and sent your way over television with the help of 29 cameras, dozens of crews, and literally miles and miles of cable. Now, of course, this is not so much a show as it is a special event. The rehearsal went about the way you'd expect a rehearsal to go if you were covering three volcanoes all erupting at the same time and you didn't expect any of them. So, from time to time, if I say we take you now by camera to the snapping crocodiles in Adventureland, and instead somebody pushes the wrong button and we catch Irene Dunne adjusting her bustle on the Mark Twain, don't be too surprised. It's all in fun, and that's what we're here for. The grounds are loaded with about 15,000 people who are especially invited guests of Walt Disney's. And they're here from movie land, from motion picture and correspondence, from every possible kind of activity connected with the opening of the eighth wonder of the world. In fact, I think I'll get off these tracks right now and go over and meet some of the people here waiting for the train to come in. And since this is a family affair, I thought you might be interested in seeing the rest of the Linkletters who are all gathered around me. And to show you exactly what happens now, I let them all take a little vote. Diane, you're six. Where would you like to go of all the places in Disneyland? Pick any one.
To the great big castle where Sleeping Beauty is.
Oh, you want to go to the castle. Sharon, you're eight. What would you like to see?
I think I'd like to go to see Frontierland when Davy Crockett fights the Indians.
Davy Crockett. Robert, what would you like to see?
I want to take the boat trip down the Congo.
And Dawn?
I think I'll take a cruise to the moon in the rocket ship over at Tomorrowland.
And Jack?
I want to see Bob Cummings.
Oh, Bob Cummings. Lois, you take them all to wherever they want to go. Right. Bob Cummings, come on in here.
I'm so glad your son said that.
Yeah, you know Bob's going to help out here in jumping all over the grounds, describing the various things. And
that's
where do you
right
go first?
Well, I go down on Main Street here and go into an old-fashioned car called a Premier, and I'll be seeing you.
In a couple of minutes.
Fine.
Ronnie Reagan, come on in.
Yeah, and how about that son of yours? I've been buttering up to him all morning, hoping he'd say that about me.
Isn't this a riot today?
Oh, it certainly is.
And, Ron, your first job is down here in the town square.
Right out here in front of the depot, yes, for the Main Street and the parade and so forth.
We have lots to do. Get busy.
Okay.
So long, Ron. Thanks for coming out. Well, ladies and gentlemen, right about now, Walt Disney aboard the E.P. Ripley, the miniature Santa Fe Disneyland Railroad train, should be barreling around the outskirts of this tremendous and fantastic spot. It's a mile and a quarter track, and it's a trip that's out of this world, because inside that circle is a brand new eighth wonder of the world. First, there's Adventureland. Yes, a visit by boat to remote and adventurous regions of the world. Then, of course, there's Tomorrowland. The time is 1986 there. The place is a city of the future, where a trip to the moon is an everyday thing. Then there's Frontierland. Ah, that's a visit to America's historic past with Davy Crockett himself there. A legendary land made real. Fantasyland, well, this is really the theme symbol of the whole Disneyland. and the thing nearest and dearest to Walt Disney's heart. Out this way, there's a heliport. And actually, helicopters land there with passengers from the international airport. Then on around, you see the tremendous parking lot where 12,000 cars can be parked. 24,000 if they pave over the first 12,000 and then park at others on top of them. Of course, that's a little the hard way. On the perimeter, out where those orange groves are, which surround this place completely, and this place was an orange grove itself a year ago, there are 5 motor hotels going up. And coming in the gate are all kinds of families. Hey, Danny Thomas! Hey, how are you? That's Danny and his gang and representatives of the press. Thousands are coming in. They're going through the magic tunnel on foot because no car can enter here. And like Alice in Wonderland, as you go on through that tunnel past the Disneyland Santa Fe, you find yourself in a bygone time. Another world. The clock has turned back a half a century, and you're in the main square of a small American town, the year 1900. Let's take a look around. There's the City Hall, quaint and dignified with its post office, the place where the citizens of the town gather to exchange gossip and hear the latest news of the day. Fire station, that's a special interest to the volunteer bucket brigade, whose horse-drawn engine and up-to-date hose and chemical wagon are a source of real local pride. Then there's the car barn housing the horse-drawn streetcar, a great boon to speedy transportation, and that little old streetcar will be going up and down Main Street here in Disneyland about every 10 or 15 minutes, day in and day out. It goes by a whole flock of very interesting and quaint little stores. There's the Emporium, where a lady could buy Lyle stockings or a silver button hook, or for a dollar, the new pair of tan high button shoes. Main Street, USA, and every one of those buildings is 5/8 real size. The doorways, of course, and the windows are full size, but the buildings themselves are 5/8. The people you see up and down the street, however, are full-size people. They were not made by Walt Disney. The old-time music shop should be in there somewhere. If you were a courting a gal, that's where you buy your mandolin or your banjo and start tuning it up for the Sunday canoe ride. Oh, you kid, 23 skidoo. The town square is where the band holds forth, and those free band concerts were one of the big social highlights of the week, any week. Or the Grand Opera House, where a Jenny Lind or a Chautauqua lecture might take place. And if you were daring, you might go out with your girl for a ride in an 1898 locomobile, the hot rod of its day. Is that one coming up Main Street? Well, yes, and Bob Cummings is aboard. Take it away, Bob.
All right. Now, here I am down here on Main Street. I got my whole family with me, my lovely wife, Mary, and my daughter, Melinda, and Bob. You know, this is a Main Street, ladies and gentlemen, just like my grandma used to tell me about back in Joplin, Missouri. Sometimes she had a whole penny for herself to spend on a Saturday night. Now, all these stores are different. For instance, now, right over here is the Candy Palace. Now, that's probably where grandma got those licorice whips and the jujubes. And, of course, right next door to the left is the Penny Arcade, which is complete with all sorts of shooting galleries and kinetoscopes. A kinetoscope, in case you don't know, is the forerunner of the original silent motion picture. And, of course, there's the bake shop. And then there's the jams and jelly stores. Mom, old grandma, certainly loved those tarts and those rich lady fingers. Of course, on the corner is the ice cream store. I guess next to Mary and Grandpa, the biggest thrill she ever had was to have a dish of Tutti Frutti ice cream and a sarsaparilla. Of course, over on the corner across the street is an old-fashioned popcorn machine, if you can see it through the crowd. And say, on the Gibson greeting card corner, right there, I think is a monkey and an organ grinder. I can't quite see him now. Oh, here he is, there, right in front of the Swift Market House. That's where all of us ham actors will originally wind up. And say, if you can pan your camera down here a little further, here is one of the most famous motion picture theaters in the world. It'll be here at Disneyland. They run exactly six silent motion pictures at once at the theater. Your camera's just coming around on it now, I can see. And believe me, if Grandma was here, she'd come and see one of the series of Perils of Pauline tonight. Say, as a matter of fact, this is so interesting, Art. I think I'll take the whole family out right now and take a look at it. What do you say, huh?
Thank you, Bob Cummings, for that word picture. But right now, we got to get back here. The E.P. Ripley is rolling around the Santa Fe Disneyland Railroad tracks with Walt Disney at the controls. And in the cab with him, you may be surprised to know, is the governor of the state of California and the president of Santa Fe, Mr. Gurley himself. And in the cars behind the 5/8 size train, you'll see the little boys and girls dressed in the foreign costumes of their countries, because they are the children of the foreign consuls located here in Los Angeles. Now, the track is 1.5 miles around. The train runs about every 10 or 12 minutes. In fact, there are two trains. There's a passenger train and there's a freight train. And each one can take several hundred passengers. It takes about 6 minutes to go around the track, which is built on a ramp that completely encircles Disneyland and cuts it out from the outside world. So once you get inside Disneyland, all you see are the various kingdoms. Now, if you look on down the track, you see Mickey Mouse there at the controls. And that's an exact duplicate of the engines that ran over 50 years ago. You can see the conductor there with his brass buttons glistening in the sun, the arms of the children. Hello, Walt. Hello, Governor.
Hi.
Boy, how would the run go?
Oh, fine, fine. The governor had her around through Frontierland, and then Fred Gurley there, he took her around. I picked her up and brought her in. Highballing in, boy.
Hello, Walt. Governor.
Glad to see you, Art.
Governor Knight of California, ladies and gentlemen, and Walt Disney, of course, and Mr. Gurley, the president of the Santa Fe.
And of the Santa Fe and Disneyland, if you please.
That's right.
Now, vice president of Santa Fe and Disneyland.
You gentlemen have lots to do down in the square, so we'll see you at the dedication.
Fine. Thank you, Art.
All right, there they go. And here come a lot. Hello, Johnny. Hello, Bunny. Johnny Green, Ron Button, and all the passengers. And I've got to get down and start getting ready to cover the parade, which is going to go down Main Street in a couple of seconds. And after a few words from your sponsor, Ronnie Reagan will take it away for the dedication ceremonies to Disneyland.
Center of Main Street, ready for the official opening ceremonies. All activity on Main Street has ceased. Those carriages which have lined up for the parade to follow are full of celebrities. Walt Disney, Governor Knight, the mayor of Anaheim, and other dignitaries are talking to the three chaplains representing the Protestant, Catholic, and Jewish faiths. And now, Walt Disney will step forward to read the dedication of Disneyland.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future. Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams, and the hard facts that have created America, with the hope that it will be a source of joy and inspiration to all the world. Thank you.
Military chaplains representing the various creeds are present, but all were agreed that
it would
be most
fitting. I have known Walt Disney for many years and have long been aware of the spiritual motivation in the heart of this man who has dreamed Disneyland into being. Let us join with him, then, in dedicating these wonder-filled acres to those things dear to his heart and ours, to understanding and goodwill among men, laughter for children, memories for the mature, and aspiration for young people everywhere. And beyond the creeds that would divide us, let us unite in a silent prayer that this and every worthy endeavor may prosper at God's hand. Let us bow in prayer. Amen.
That was Walt Disney's nephew, the Reverend Glenn D. Pewter. And now, the Honorable Goodwin
Thank
Knight,
you,
Governor
Ronald
of
Reagan,
California.
Mr. and Mrs. Disney, Reverend clergy, and my fellow Americans. Today is a wonderful day, and all America is proud as we open Disneyland. This is a wondrous community with all the charm of the old world and all of the progress and ingenuity of the new world. Yes, this is a wonderful place for children and grown-ups alike. There are replicas of every town and city in America, stores, libraries, schools, just like your hometown, all built by American labor and American capital under the belief that this is a God-fearing and a God-loving country. And as we dedicate this flag now, we do it with the knowledge that we are the fortunate ones to be Americans, and that we extend to everyone everywhere the great ideals of Americanism, brotherhood, and peace on earth, goodwill towards men.
And any moment now, a flight of planes from the 146th Fighter Interceptor Wing of the California Air National Guard will be over as a tribute to Governor Goodwin Knight. Now the parade is on. And here we go to the roof of a Main Street building and Art Linkletter.
The United States Marine Band coming up Main Street. The Color Guard has just passed. The Massed Armed Forces Color Guard from all the four armed services. And behind the Marine Band comes the Grand Marshal's 1903 Pierce with Walt Disney and Governor Knight.
Wife.
And his wife, Virginia Knight. And then come the 1904 Rambler with Marjorie Raine and this is a real cavalcade of Disneyland characters.
Here comes the Disneyland Band.
Yeah, directed by V.C. Walker. And Tommy Walker. And there's Mickey and Minnie Mouse and all of the gang cavorting up and down the street.
Peter Pan.
on Pluto and Donald Duck and all the other characters are from the Walt Disney costumes created by John Harris's Ice Capades, which is on tour with Peter Pan right now around the United States. In the distance comes the floats. That's Cinderella riding in a golden coach, pulled by two ponies, with a doorman and a driver, and Prince Charming on a white horse carrying Cinderella's glass slipper. And
there's Snow White, and she's sitting there with the seven dwarfs.
Oh, yes, and listen to the kids in the crowd here, all specially invited for an all-free party on Walt Disney. Now here comes the frontier land, and of course, who would be up near the front but Davy Crockett?
Old Fez Parker, he's the beard and all.
And the Davy Crockett Mounted Scouts. Buddy Ebsen's there, too. Annie Oakley, the hostess girl for the Carnation Ice Cream Pavilion here on Main Street, is riding with them. The Conestoga coaches and wagons have Governor Frank Clement of Tennessee riding aboard. Aye. And there's Annie Oakley coming up now.
Dave Stokes back there.
And the buckboard stagecoach is Gail Storm and Danny Thomas and his family. He's a popular fellow with all the crowd.
Look at all those kids. The Minutemen, they're back there.
Yeah.
Here come the Indians. Here's the Indian Firewater on the horse Firewater.
Yeah. This is a real all-star parade of characters, all of whom will be seen in later episodes of our introduction to Disneyland.
Here come a bunch of square dancers dancing on a little thing drawn by horses.
Yes, and they're actually calling square dances up there. The Boy Scouts of America, the Orange Empire Council, helped out in the Indian group, by the way. Right behind the square dancing is a very small group, but for representing a very important group, Adventureland. Well, I guess we got more parade than we can handle today. Bob Cummings, you better take it away wherever you are.
Yes, sir. Okay, Art Linkletter, thank you very much. You did a wonderful job there describing that. I'm at the head of the parade now, ladies and gentlemen, and my job here is to more or less give you an orientation process because I am standing at about the center of this giant 160-acre of Disneyland. Now, if you can visualize where I'm standing, the parade is coming directly to my back towards your camera. Off to your left is the fabulous Tomorrowland. Directly behind you is Fantasyland, which you will all see very soon. Directly to your right is Frontierland and the Old West. And directly to your right and slightly forward is Adventureland. Now, of course, all the segments of this wonderful parade and their casts are now breaking up, and they're going to the various sections of Disneyland. Tomorrowland, Fantasyland, Adventureland, and Frontierland, as I told you. Standing here has been one of the most exciting moments of my life. I think, ladies and gentlemen, that anyone who's been here today will say, as the people did many years ago when they were at the opening of the Eiffel Tower, I was there. I'm very proud to say I was at the opening of Disneyland. It's a fabulous thing to happen, ladies and gentlemen. Well, this is one of the greatest parades, man-made parades, I've ever seen. Walt Disney has done one of the most fabulous jobs of gathering together talent and workmen.
In just 1 minute, we will start our exciting trip to Frontierland, the Old West, and Davy Crockett.
Before you enter this realm, I'd like to read this dedication, which will be inscribed on a plaque. Frontierland, it is here that we experience the story of our country's past. The color, romance, and drama of frontier America as it developed from wilderness trails to roads, riverboats, railroads, and civilization. A tribute to the faith, courage, and ingenuity of our hardy pioneers who blazed the trails and made this progress possible.
And this is Frontierland. Inside this stockade, Walt Disney has created a frontier village that could have been carved out of the wilderness 100 years ago by the pioneers themselves. The flag flying over the stockade has 13 stars commemorating America's first period of independence. And that volley signals the arrival of a wagon train with the first visitors to travel through the gates of time and into our very historic past. And now, inside Frontierland to Art Linkletter.
Frontierland, Conestoga wagons, riders and all, off the big Main Street parade. They're going on into the stagecoach country. Yes, sir, there's little Annie Oakley, and there are the special horses, 5'8" size, bred by Walt Disney, and Danny Thomas. The cameras are in the other direction, Danny. Yeah, there they go. And kids, there goes a Wells Fargo-type stagecoach with Gail Storm and her kids inside, and what do you think of this, Robert?
Great.
Uh-huh. Looking for anything special?
Davy Crockett.
Well, Davy Crockett ought to be around here someplace. In the meantime, let's take a little look around. Over here where the little burros and horses are, and down there is the Davy Crockett Museum. What do you think of that, Sharon?
Oh, it's fine, but where's Davy Crockett?
Where's Davy Crockett? Well, he's out someplace where the Indians are. Down there is the Frontier Trading Post. Isn't that exciting, Robert?
It sure is, but I still don't know where Davy Crockett is.
Well, I'll tell you what we're going to do. I'm going to give you this gun, Robert. You point it up in the air, and when you fire it, that'll bring Davy Crockett. Another one. There it goes. Now, everybody look over in that direction. I think we're going to see Davy Crockett very shortly. Keep your eyes on those hills.
Davy Crockett, the Buckskin Buccaneer. Born on the mountaintop in Tennessee, greatest state in the land of the free. Raised in the woods, so he knew every tree. Killed him a bar when he was only three.
There he comes!
There comes Davy! King of the wild frontier. Davy Crockett! King of the wild frontier. King of the wild frontier.
Hi, Davy! And Russell, too. Come on over here, fellas. You're a little late getting in. Must have been some trouble on the trail someplace.
Well,
hi, Fess. What happened?
We'd have been here sooner, but we took a shortcut through the painted desert.
Yeah, there was too much paint, too. War paint.
Indians?
Them redskins was just itching to lift our scalps.
Well, what did you do?
Well, I got out old Betsy, but before I could draw a bead on the chief, Georgia here spilled his canteen on my gunpowder.
Yeah, then when I grabbed from a tomahawk, dang that the head didn't come right off in my hand. So there we was. No dry gunpowder, no tomahawk. And all the time, them redskins was creeping closer and closer, and their hot breath was breathing down the backs of our necks.
Oh, you were a goner, Davy. What'd you do?
Nothing.
Nothing?
We just let those Indians breathe away till their hot breath dried out that gunpowder, and then old Betsy took over.
Oh, what a story.
I've sure been a goner without.
Tell me another story, Davy.
One day I took my leave from town. I aimed a grin, a wildcat down. The beast and I began to stare. Was a growling grizzly bear.
When old Betsy, the one and only Betsy, I can travel far and wide with Betsy by my side.
Yes, sir. This is a gun that did it, folks.
Tell them about when you went to gather whittling sticks.
Oh, yeah.
I got myself into a fix. I was picking whittling sticks. The snow was frozen on the ground. Pack of hungry wolves came round.
When old Betsy,
my one and only Betsy,
I can travel far and wide with Betsy by my side.
About the trouble you had with the engine.
when I was riding through the woods. Trade off skins for bought and goods. 40 arrows hit a tree. I knew the Sioux were out for me.
When old Betsy, the one and only Betsy, I can travel far and wide with Betsy by my side.
Wonderful rides here in Pioneer Land and Frontier Land. There's horses and there's mules and there's wagons and there's some little kids over there waiting for a mule ride. Fess, buddy, why don't we give them the thrill of their lives by going over and putting them on the mule ride for the first time?
Well,
come on over here.
We'll return to Frontier Land, to the stage of the Golden Horseshoe, to Old New Orleans and the maiden voyage of the Mississippi River boat, the Mark Twain, in just a moment.
We're stole a herd of cattle. They didn't know the herd they stole was
Bill. Yes, sir. This is Bob Cummings again. Now, Art Linkletter has just gone down to the landing to give a wonderful send-off to the riverboat Mark Twain on its maiden voyage. But before we join him, I'd like to have you see Slewfoot Sioux's Golden Horseshoe. It's really the showplace of the frontier. You know, in the folklore of the Old West, there were so many legends that were real, and they became men. And so many men that were so real, they became legends. And, of course, Slewfoot Sioux was the girlfriend of Pecos Bill, the tallest man of the tallest tales of the Old Southwest. Now, if you can listen now, you'll hear that they're playing a song all about Pecos Bill. So, come on, let's go inside and see what's happening, huh? Well, I tell you, Slewfoot Sioux boasts the longest little bar in the entire wide world, with the tallest glass of soda pop. Now, of course, as you begin to see the interior, there's the stage. And the orchestra, just like in the old, old days. Up in a box above me, I don't think you can see them, is Ken Murray and his wife, Betty Lou. And, of course, there's General Clarence Shoup. And Mrs. Shoup, who's Julie Bishop, an old leading lady of mine. Aren't those gorgeous, those girls doing the can-can? And the audience is so enthusiastic here, ladies and gentlemen. Incidentally, this beautiful ceiling is also 5/8 scale. And everything here has been built especially by Walt Disney for this old dance hall of the old days. That whistle you hear, ladies and gentlemen, means that the Mark Twain is ready down at the dock. We don't want to miss the launching ceremony, so come in, my friend Art Linkletter.
A stern wheel riverboat, something most living Americans have never seen. A popular boat up and down the Mississippi. 50 years ago and more, and Walt Disney has built this great, big, beautiful, authentic stern wheel paddle boat from keel to smokestack. $250,000 worth of boat that hasn't been built in America for 50 years. Loaded with gay and carefree, happy passengers, a band playing up there in the second deck, which is the grand salon deck, all paneled in special woods, ready for the parties of the year. And incidentally, Walt Disney and his wife, Lily, celebrated their 30th anniversary last Wednesday, right here in a special party aboard the Mark Twain. But right now, it's my pleasure to introduce the lovely lady and famous star whom Mr. Disney has asked to christen the Mark Twain. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Irene Dunn. Hello, Irene.
How are you? It's listing.
It's listing a little because it'll be shoving off in a moment.
Yes, well, this is an authentic stern wheeler. Did you know that? 105 feet long.
Well, how do you know all this?
Well, you see, my father used to be supervising general of steamships in America, and my grandfather used to build boats like this.
I'll bet your dad would love to be here today, up there standing by the wheelhouse.
I can almost see him standing up there now with the captain alongside of him, just as though it were the greatest place in the world.
Well, now, Miss Dunn, you're holding a very special bottle here in your arms.
Yes, I am, Walt. You see, this bottle contains waters from all the leading rivers in America.
Brought here from all these towns by the great rivers.
That's right. So with these precious waters, I'm going to christen this boat the Mark Twain.
And there the boat is christened, and it starts on its daily trips up and down the rivers of the world. Of America, that is. Thank you, Miss Dunn.
Thank you.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, I've got other places to go. And the Commodore, Admiral Joe Fowler, up there in the wheelhouse, looks like they're getting ready to shove off. So I better... Goodbye, Irene. And goodbye, everybody. Have a good ride. There goes the whistle. Take her away, Admiral. Goodbye. Have a good trip.
Mark Twain as she gets ready to start on her maiden voyage. The Mark Twain, a proud symbol of that romantic era when whole cities grew out of river ports. The churning paddle wheels brought new people, new customs, and new industries to those fabulous ports of call, Pittsburgh, St. Louis, and Natchez. Riverboat even brought a new kind of music up the river from the city where the blues were born, where the Dixieland style was king, New Orleans.
Ah, yes, sir, folks, Bob Cummings again. Isn't it great? It's the real thing, all right. Now, right now, we're in a street, just like in New Orleans. The old New Orleans created for Walt Disney for you. And standing right here behind me is probably the most famous little Dixieland band in the world, the Firehouse 5 Plus 2. And they're in exactly the right place because New Orleans is the spot where this beat was born. The Barrel House, the blues. So take it away, Firehouse 5. Burn it up, boys. Thank you.
Here's Aunt Jemima.
As you can see, I'd like to stay here at the Mardi Gras forever, but there's a Disneyland train leaving from the Western Station right away, and we don't want to miss that. It's taking us to more an exciting land, so take it away on the train, Ronnie Regan.
Thanks, Bob. This is the Western Railway Station. And this is the CK Holiday, the Disneyland Freight. And it's on its way now, leaving Frontierland and going 100 years into the future to Tomorrowland.
One minute from now, Walt Disney will present a preview of Tomorrowland and the fascinating world of the future in the year 1986.
Words of dedication. A vista into a world of wondrous ideas, signifying man's achievements. I thought I got a signal. Before our preview of Tomorrowland, I'd like to read these few words of dedication. A vista into a world of wondrous ideas, signifying man's achievement, a step into the future, with predictions of constructive things to come. Tomorrow offers new frontiers in science, adventure, and ideals, the atomic age, the challenge of outer space, and the hope for a peaceful and unified world.
Those doves are, ladies and gentlemen, I hope, the harbingers of peace for the world of tomorrow. And now, here in Disneyland, the year is 1986. That's way ahead. And that's when Halley's Comet will flash past the Earth again. And the time of its arrival will be recorded on a futuristic clock like this one here, which tells you, incidentally, at a glance, the exact time on any spot on the Earth. Yes, this is Tomorrowland. And it's not a stylized dream of the future, but a scientifically planned projection of future techniques by leading space experts and scientists. Now, whether you visit this spot, the spaceport of the future, to experience the thrills of a rocket trip to the moon, or perhaps you go to see the Circle-rama, that's a motion picture screen that completely encircles the audience, or perhaps this 70-foot model of a rocket-powered ship poised to blast off into outer space, you find yourself living predictions of things to come. Well, further out, just beyond here, next to Tomorrowland, is Autotopia, and that's the superhighway of the future. Art Linkletter will be along shortly to tell you all about it. Of each of our 48 states.
now being unfurled are the efficient colors of the 48 states of this nation. It's appropriate that the Eagle Scouts handle this ceremony because these boys represent the citizens of the future. The world of tomorrow belongs to them. And now we'll take you into the future again in the aluminum exhibit and show you the aluminum telescope. Bob Cummings, take it away.
Well, we have here several exhibits that show you all about an atomic chain reaction. And here I have in my hand a...
Oh, hello, Bob.
How do you do, Professor Haber? Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to present to you a gentleman of considerable renown. This is Dr. Heinz Haber, and I'm sure you will remember him from Walt Disney's Tomorrowland. Mr. Haber has a very interesting experiment to show us here as we stand in front of this giant aluminum telescope, which was built especially for the Disneyland show. Go ahead, Doctor. Please tell us about it.
Bob, I must just explain to these kids that I have here an atom of uranium.
I see.
But, of course, it's only a loaded mousetrap.
It is, isn't it?
But the two things have one in common. They contain energy. It can be released by a trigger like this.
Oh, yes.
You could say that this is splitting atoms.
Yes, we have that around home. Is your son and daughter?
Yes. She's my daughter.
Very nice. Nice to see you,
but
kid.
Now, when an atom splits, it releases two neutrons.
I see.
The famous atomic particles that are found in the interior of atomic nuclei.
I see.
If they split, they are given off. Like this. Watch.
Yes, you're giving off light toward the camera, too.
Yes, people are very much interested in these things.
Yes.
And this is why here in Tomorrowland, we are basically preparing a show for you that tells all about the atom and what the atomic age will be like in the future.
I see.
You see, nature's energy comes from the atom, too.
Mm-hmm.
Through atomic energy, we get solar heat. And through sunshine, clouds, and rain, we are getting water power.
I see.
And with water power, we produce electricity for our show.
Right.
Now, soon we can do this in a shortcut with the atomic pile that will be able to produce for us electricity. Now to show you how a pile looks inside, I have here on this table over 100 mouse traps, and they're all loaded and ready to go. Now you can imagine what happens if I throw just one neutron ping pong ball into this pile of loaded traps. It triggers one, it gives off neutrons, and it triggers further. And finally, the whole pile will go off in a few seconds.
Well, that's amazing.
And this is a chain reaction. Would you like to start it?
Well, I don't think that I should do that. I'm a little shocked. Say, why don't we just have your son standing right here, Doctor? Why don't you start the chain reaction with the ping pong ball to demonstrate to our audience?
Okay.
Huh?
Stay back, everybody. Well, try again.
Try again.
Now, what you have seen here with the mousetraps and the ping pong balls is an important part of your future, the power of the atom. And if you grow up, be certain that you use it wisely.
Now we're in Autopia, about a mile of superhighway adventure with all the kids lined up in little gasoline-driven automobiles that go whistling around the various freeway and highway convolutions at 11 miles an hour. These are gasoline driven, and the kids can drive to their heart's content with their parents or without their parents. Where are you going? Oh, stay right there. I didn't know where you... I thought I was going to be run over here for a second. Now, the entire Autopia goes by a lake and by canals. There's scenic features, and look who's riding in the various cars. Coming down the road here is my old friend Don DeFore. Ozzy and Harriet's next door neighbor. Come on right by. Hello, Don. Good to see you. Keep on going. Here's Jeannie Crane. Hello, Jean. Frank Sinatra. Hello, Franco. Who's driving? Frankie Jr.?
My son, yeah.
Don't hit this man. Oh. Look who hit who. Sammy Davis Jr. Hello, Sammy. And where's Gail? Gail Storm should be coming by here in just a second with her kitties. She's here with Peter and Paul, and they're all skimming around up there on the freeway. There's Mrs. DeFore. Now, these all have aluminum bumpers completely around them, as you might see over here, so they can't hurt anybody, and they have governors on them. They only run 11 miles an hour. And, of course, the women drivers are given a little special space, just as they are on the highways. Well, we got a lot more celebrities coming up. Come up here, Gail. I want you to see one of the prettiest gals in the world, Miss Gail Storm, and her little boy. We've been waiting for you, honey. Hi. How was the ride?
Well, I tell you, that's the greatest ride I ever had.
Thank you. Well, we ought to go down to the boat landing. Ronnie Reagan, are you there? Take it away.
Well, thank you very much, Art. And here on the Lake of Tomorrowland, we have boats made out of fiberglass, and they're as strong and safe as anything afloat. And I have two customers right here, Bonita Granville and Jack Rather.
Hi, Ronnie.
Hi, Ronnie. How are you?
Just fine. And say, I've seen you since we left the bus early this morning here.
Well, we had a nice ride out, and we've had a big day here.
Oh, boy. Can you see it all in one day?
Oh, it's impossible. It's a fabulous place.
And that gets me around to the other point. You're sort of interested in a hotel arrangement around here, aren't you?
Yes. We're billing the Disneyland Hotel, which is right at the exit to Disneyland Park.
And you and Nancy have got to bring the kids and come out and stay with us.
When are you going to open?
We're opening part of it in September and the rest of it in January, Ronnie.
We shall be there in September.
Fine.
And now, in the meantime, why don't you have a boat ride? You know, this is a good chance to tell the people that's a $10 million hotel with swimming pool and everything. Then you can take 2 or 3 days.
Good.
Okay, have a boat ride.
You
bet.
We'll come back to Tomorrowland in just a moment to take you for a thrilling rocket ship ride into space.
Conquest of space. Exploring the future and the unknown up in the universe is probably the last big challenging problem left to man, Danny.
It just about is. As a matter of fact, I'm absolutely flabbergasted at this fantastic place of amusement that Walt Disney and Company have
created. And I would say that this is one of the most exciting. Captain Barton, come over here. This is Danny Thomas, Captain Barton. He's in charge of our two rocket ships. What are their names?
Diana and Luna.
Oh, after the moon.
Right.
Now, are you blasting off very shortly?
Just a few seconds, I'd say.
Danny doesn't want to go. He's a little skeptical.
You mean the thing really goes up?
You don't want to leave the Earth, Danny?
No, I certainly do not.
I think you've been out of this world for years, kid. Captain, you go over and get aboard the ship, and we'll contact you in a minute.
All right, fine.
All right.
Does it really go up?
Yeah, you see, there are two ships. They each accommodate about 103 people.
Uh-huh.
And as a matter of fact, you over there, Captain Barton?
Yeah.
Ready to blast off? All right. Well, take it away, and let's take a little look at what it looks like.
Right. Just a minute. Have a look at that back.
Oh, yeah.
I'd like to give you some idea about the rocket ship itself and explain some of the more interesting highlights of our operation here. Now, this will give you a pretty good idea of the rocket ship in which you will soon be traveling to the moon. Now, here is the captain's cockpit. And here are the crew's quarters. And this is the passenger section. In this section are two television screens, one above and another one below. So when the flight gets underway, you'll be able to see by watching the upper screen what's ahead of you, and by watching the lower screen, you can see what you've left behind. Now, this chart shows the flight path of the rocket ship Star of Polaris, which will be taking off shortly for the moon. Now, this is a typical flight path and approximates the one of your own trip.
Clear field preparatory to takeoff. Clear field preparatory to takeoff.
Attention blastoff crew. Attention blastoff crew. Report to Space Dock 3. Attention fire control crew. Attention fire control crew. Report to Space Dock 1. All field personnel take blastoff stations. All field personnel take blastoff stations.
Field control to tower. Field has been cleared for takeoff.
Check. Tower to Captain Rocket Ship TWA Star of Polaris. You've been cleared for takeoff, Captain. Stand by.
Captain Star of Polaris. All ready.
Starting countdown. 15 seconds. X-14, X-13, X-12, X-11, X-10, X-9, X-8, X-7, X-6, X-5, X-4, X-3, X-2, X-1. Fire!
This is Captain Barton again from Disneyland Operations, switching you back to the Rocket Polaris for more highlights of this space trip.
Per second. During the time I've been speaking, we've risen another 10,000 feet. We are assuming our flight course, which will take us over the Arctic Circle. You'll find most of the polar cap will be in shadow or night side. In a few moments, we'll be 1,075 miles high and past the orbit of the space station Terra.
Disneyland Spaceport, calling Terra Space Station. Come in.
Disneyland, this is Terra. Go ahead.
Roger, Terra. You have Polaris contact?
Terra to Disneyland Spaceport. Roger, have contacted rocket ship Star Polaris. There it is.
Kingdom Hall, after a word from your announcer and the commercial.
In just 35 seconds, we'll explore all the magic wonders of Fantasyland and meet the immortal Mickey Mouse, Snow White, Cinderella, Peter Pan, and a host of others on Dateline Disneyland.
This is ABC Television Network.
Dedication for the happiest kingdom of them all, Fantasyland. Here is a world of imagination, hopes, and dreams. In this timeless land of enchantment, the age of chivalry, magic, and make-believe are reborn, and fairy tales come true. Fantasyland is dedicated to the young and the young in heart, to those who believe that when you wish upon a star, your dreams do come true.
This is Ronald Reagan again, and I'm very happy now to show you these young people. Since Disneyland opened, these children have been eagerly waiting to cross the moat for a wondrous trip through the Disney imagination. They'll be the first children to enjoy the Fantasyland rides, every one of which recreates the adventures of characters Walt has immortalized in films.
Fantasyland Castle, in the name of the children of the world.
You wish upon
Through here, and the pirate galleon is hanging on a monorail, and it flies, first of all, out through a moonbeam sea, out over London town, and down below are all the lights twinkling. And then they go past the second star to the right, and of course, they go to Never Never Land, flying past Skull Rock and Pirate Cove, and they have adventures with the Indians and Lost Boys and Captain Crewe, Captain Hook, I mean. Oh, have you heard of Captain Hook?
Yeah.
You aren't scared of him, are you?
No.
No, no. And his buccaneers? What's your name?
Ruth.
Hello. You're going to have fun in there, aren't you?
Yes.
Well, they're loading them up on these pirate galleons. And it looks as if this is going to be one of the most exciting rides of all, because as they go through, they see everything that Peter Pan saw. You're going to come back here in a minute. Right now, Bob Cummings is at the... where is he? He's at the Snow White ride. Bob, come on in.
Bob Cummings again, back with you, and like the Peter Pan fly-through.
It looks like one of our first little boys has just come off his ride, and he's getting a souvenir. Look what he's collected. Alan Young. What do you mean by that, Alan?
Oh, that was wonderful.
Is that a good ride?
Oh, I flew over London 3 months ago, and this was the same thing. I got my passport and everything. Just great.
And you took Captain Hook with you?
I brought him along for the ride. Thank
you.
Well,
folks, Ronnie and Bob and I are going to come back with more stories of Fantasyland as soon as you hear another word on the commercial. Who's paying the bill? Take it away. How many children do you have?
Right there. is Casey Jones, Jr., the famous little
Here
circus train.
Here we are
train
the Casey
with a great
Jones,
big heart.
Jr. circus train. That's a little engine with a great big heart. And it has the calliope and the lion cage wagons and everything the kids ride in. And here are the DeFores. Don,
Mrs.
and kids, you jump right in that wagon there.
And away we go. Wonderful.
Here's Margaret Whiting, a favorite songbird of mine. And you got your little sister, Barbara?
Yes, I do.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Marjorie Main, are you going to take a ride? And let's go on down. Oh, look who the engineer is. If my eyes don't see me, Jerry Colonna.
What?
Are you the honorary engineer?
Why, yes, and we're all aboard.
Take her away.
Junior Circus Special.
And there they go. Jerry Colonna's highballing it, and the kids are getting aboard. That's enough. Let it go. Let it go. No more children. There they go. Goodbye, kids. Well, now they're going to go out across the trestles and over the hills and by the canal. Look, there are two of them up there, cutting over the many grades and many curves and hills which take them over this end of Fantasyland. And down below them are the canals. And in the canals go the various boats. And right now, I've got to get over to Mr. Toad's ride. So Bob Cummings, up on the pirate ship. Take it, Bob.
What would happen if you and sat on there so you get down a little lower and get your head over the
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob Cummings again. I don't know whether the cameras are picking me up or not. They're simply marvelous. They've got Zumar lenses and they're a mile away. Of course, I'm on a real old-fashioned pirate ship, and sitting beside me is a man who's almost an authority on that, and his name, ladies and gentlemen, Bobby Driscoll. Hello,
Hi, Bob.
Bobby.
How are you today?
I'm just wonderful.
Isn't
and you?
Wonderful?
It's just great. You know, Bobby Driscoll starred in Walt Disney's Treasure Island, and that was some time ago when you were a little boy. You're grown up now, and quite an exciting thing. You never thought this would happen, did you?
No, it's just marvelous.
Isn't it wonderful,
just
though?
Terrific.
You know, looking at Fantasyland from where we are at this spot is simply fantastic.
See the whole thing.
And oh, and I see Art Linkletter right now. Art Linkletter is looking for a microphone. He looks all confused. He's standing over there in front of the Mr. Toad's Wild Ride. And I think if he ever gets a microphone, we'll be able to talk to him because he's waving his arm. There's been something gone wrong here for just an instant. But you can't wonder, ladies and gentlemen, this is a tremendous, tremendous affair today. 160 acres of fantasy, and it's just great. Now, here he comes with his microphone. He's coming out, Art Linkletter. Mr. Disney's great picture, Wind in the Willows, inspires this ride, Mr. Toad, on a 1903 automobile. And believe me, this ride is the wildest of them all. The automobile goes through on a monorail, pursued through London town by police, crashing through walls, and finally goes in to a tunnel. And as you go into the railroad tunnel, you apparently see a train coming in the opposite direction. You can't turn. You can't escape. There's a tremendous collision head-on to the locomotive, and then I can't tell you the finish because I don't want to spoil it for you. This is the ride that not only parents should go with children, but the parents' parents should go with the parents. Danny Thomas, this is just the ride for you. Go on in. Oh, this is after that last ride. This one's easy.
It's a mild ride.
Yeah.
Gary?
Oh, nothing.
What is it?
Go on in.
Is it a mild ride?
It's an easy ride.
That's so.
That's it. Just go right on
Like a merry-go-round?
Yeah, that's right.
Gary?
Come on. It's real easy, you said.
Sure. Bob Cummings up in the pirate ship. We're back to you, boy.
Oh, you're waiting for me? Oh, thank you. Everybody is waving at Bob Cummings over here, so I guess I'm back on. I'm on the top of the pirate ship, the Chicken of the Sea pirate ship, sitting right up here with Bobby Driscoll, and I think I can see coming now two of the most important people here at Fantasyland. The real star of it is Mickey and Minnie Mouse. And they're on their way, ladies and gentlemen. I can see them coming. There they go. And they're going into the Mickey Mouse Theater, a beautiful movie house which will have a continuous performance for children who visit Fantasyland.
It seems to me we've been everywhere, haven't we?
Well, I hope so. I don't know.
Say, haven't we missed something?
Seems like it.
A whole land?
Adventureland.
Oh, that's my favorite. Let's go over there. Bob Cummings or somebody ought to be waiting to let us see that.
Well, we better hurry. We haven't got much time.
Take it away, Adventureland.
Well, this is Bob Cummings, ladies and gentlemen, again. And we are now at the beginning of a true life adventure into a still unconquered and untamed region of our own world. A Tahitian village where you can experience a slice of life as it exists in the paradise of the Pacific. And an African trading post, the spearhead of civilization in those primitive lands. Now, we're all loaded up, I believe. Thank you, Captain. You can take her off. We're ready for a ride down the tropical waterways of the world. Well, you just can't believe it, folks. The colors are so unbelievable. The banks are lined with rare trees and exotic foliage blown here from the far corners of the earth. But a brief glimpse into this marvelous network of Adventureland. But we haven't time now. We've got to take you back to see how the rest of the visitors at Disneyland are doing. So I take you back now to Dick Weston. Take it over, friend.
In exactly 1 minute, we'll be back to hear from Walt Disney.
Walt, you've made a bum out of Barnum today, but we've got to go.
I know, but I just want to say a word of thanks to all the artists, the workers, and everybody that helped make this dream come true.
Let's go into Fantasyland and have some fun.
Let's go.
Goodbye, folks.
Stay tuned for Chance of a Lifetime on ABC.